know it. It's about a 30-second delay. Hey, I'm Charles Noble, the assistant principal viola of the Oregon Symphony, and this is a little sound check that we're doing to make sure everything is working before we get going at 5 o'clock. So this is my voice test, I suppose. That's what we're doing right now. How's this? I'm a little closer now. This is probably where I'll be when I actually do the talking that I do. Yeah, the problem is if I play, it blows it out. So unless I adjust the gain every time I go to talk, which I could do, but it potentially could be not the greatest. Let me put it down lower. All right, how's this? I'm right in front of the microphone now. So, Misty, that's better. Right, so a little viola testing here. All right, so I'll get a little closer to the mic. I'm going to have to move back and forth, but anyway, I'm Charles Noble. I'm with the Oregon Symphony, and we're going to start this here happy hour thing at 5 o'clock. So if you want to send an invitation to any friends of yours that you think might be interested, that would be great. And then bring the beverage of your choice to a comfy chair. And just sit back and relax. You'll learn a little something. You'll hear some music that you might like, and maybe ask me questions on the chat thing. I see them right there as they come up. And if it's a question I feel like I can answer, I'll answer it. So looking forward to this a lot. So please get this out there. Let your friends know. We've got about 7 minutes before we start. I'm gonna do a little housekeeping around the studio. I made this little sign here so people would know what's happening. And maybe I'll do a little studio tour. I mean, you gotta see behind the curtain, and I have a little camera I can move around. So, and maybe one of my cats will come up and meow at the door, and we can meet him. So, lots of stuff planned, lots of things going on. So, really looking forward to this. So, about 6 minutes, and we'll be going live with this. I mean, more live. We're live now, but you know what I mean. Minutes. We're down to 3 minutes. Call all your friends. Let them know that we're on at 5 o'clock Pacific time. So it'll be a late happy hour for your friends on the East Coast. But if you got some friends on the East Coast, let them know. I've got a few. Hopefully, they are going to tune in. Anyway, that's what's going on. We're waiting for the thing to go. 2 minutes, 2 minutes. Make sure you make that drink and let me know what you are enjoying while you are watching and listening to me. I'd love to know what you're enjoying because I'm going to have something when I'm done and you might give me some ideas. It's almost 5. I think it is 5. Okay. Just getting my iPad squared away so I don't have messages coming up on it while I'm playing off of it. Right, let's get this set up here. Been spending most of the day trying to figure out where to put things and making sure my space is nicely arranged so that people aren't like, what's back there? But I'm going to give you a tour of kind of my studio where all the craziness happens during my everyday life as a musician. Welcome. Welcome to my little live happy hour. Really happy to be here, and thanks so much to Artslandia for this amazing idea to give artists and musicians and actors and all sorts of performing arts types a venue to still reach out to their audiences even as we're all stuck in our own homes. So, again, make sure you've got your beverage of whatever kind that you enjoy and a comfy chair to sit on. And I'm just going to give you kind of a little guided tour of the viola. And since it's April 1st, there's this thing called the viola joke. And I think most of them, well, they started out very maliciously. They started out as, violists in the very early days, oftentimes they were violinists that were put out to pasture. I read one passage where a famous composer said that violists were either violinists that could no longer play or retired horn players. So I don't know which would make the worst violist, but it sounds pretty bad to me. But anyway, the viola's come a long way, and in the early 20th century, it actually became, through the efforts of William Primrose, a Scottish violist, perhaps the greatest violist and virtuoso on the instrument that has ever lived, popularized the viola as a virtuoso instrument. He played transcriptions of the Paganini caprices that were written for violin, incredibly difficult, and inspired some great composers to write for him, including Hindemith and Walton. Each wrote a concerto for him. And so we're really lucky to have him as sort of our patron saint. So I'm going to start off by, as long as we're talking about Paganini, I'm going to start off with a piece by Henri Vieuxtemps, who's a Belgian composer who lived from 1820 to 1881. And this piece is actually, it's called Capriccio, and it's one of a set of pieces. There were five for solo violin and one for solo viola that were discovered or published after his death. And it's not really a virtuoso piece, but it is an homage to Paganini, in his words. But, and it's also, it's got that sort of viola autumnal tinge that people can't seem to avoid. Because the viola has that sort of dusky sound that's not the high soprano of the violin, and it's not the tenor of the cello. It's in between, and it's slightly imperfect because of the way the instrument is made, and we'll talk about that later. But anyway, this is Vieuxtemps, his Capriccio for solo viola. I'm going to grab my viola, and I'll be right with you. So, that was Vieuxtemps, and you can kind of get the influence of the earlier virtuoso writers for the instrument, but again, it's got that sort of autumnal tinge. It's got a little bit of kind of fast stuff happening, but always a beautiful melody that runs through the whole thing. Let's talk just a tiny bit about what a viola actually is. It looks a lot like a violin. In fact, in terms of its basic shape, it's pretty much identical to a violin. If you saw them without any context and you didn't hear it, you could easily mistake it for a violin. But it's a bit bigger. A violin might go about, oh, I don't know, about this far on mine. The body length on my viola is about 16 and 5/8 inches, and violins are around 14 or so, or a little larger, depending on the style. And it's got four strings, like a violin and the cello do, and they're tuned in fifths, just like those instruments, and they're C, G, D, and A. And basically, the viola sounds five notes lower than a violin, and it sounds an octave above the cello. Its strings are actually tuned to the same notes as cello strings. So that's why we often steal the Bach cello suites from those cellists that don't like us for doing that. But since they lay very well for us on the viola, we tend to play them a lot. They're one kind of the backbone of our repertoire, just as violinists and cellists have their solo Bach pieces as their bedrock as well. So let's talk about Bach for a minute before I play some of his music. He's really the father of European art music. Really, there was great music before him, but he took that and made something incredible that every composer since has tried to equal but failed. I mean, it's just miraculous how amazing Bach was as a composer and also apparently as an improviser on the keyboard. A lot of the great organ pieces that you hear played today were improvisations that he did just off the cuff, and then he wrote them down later. He wrote six suites for the solo cello slash viola, and I'm going to play the first suite right now in its entirety. And it's interesting with these suites, and a lot of Bach's music wasn't really well known before the 19th century. It sort of was in obscurity. Felix Mendelssohn was responsible for bringing a lot of his music back into prominence. He really championed it, and lucky for us that we have all this amazing music to play and listen to. So this is the first suite in G major. They don't really know exactly when even these pieces were written. They know they were written before the violin sonatas and partitas, that so before 1720, but they don't have an exact date, and they don't really know the order that they were composed in, but I feel like the order that they're published in, 1 through 6, they get steadily more complex as you go along, and it's a nice progression. And they have a sort of an emotional basis to each one, and I think the G major is very much very sunny, as the sun just came out, very sunny and happy and lively and very, it's to me it sounds like spring. So this is Bach's first cello suite. Thank you. is Bach's First Cello Suite. Isn't that amazing? I just feel incredible that I can even have that music to play, never mind sort of be able to play it. Gosh, it's so weird not hearing applause or anything. Not that I need it, but as a performer, you kind of are used to it. You get done, and I'm seeing lots of little hearts and little thingies coming up from the chat page, so that is awesome. Thank you very much for that. Let's see, I'm just trying to scroll through here and look at what's going on. So much action on the chat thing. Let me answer a couple questions that I see going by. So Jackie Tran asks, what do you miss the most about playing with the Oregon Symphony? And yes, Oregon Symphony member since 1995. After this season, I'll have played for 25 years in the orchestra, which I still can't get my mind around. Of course, I started when I was 5, so. What do I miss the most? You know, I miss my friends. I miss making music with other people in the same room. I miss playing for our wonderful audiences that are the entire reason that we do what we do. I miss it tremendously, and I know all my colleagues do as well. We miss playing for you. We miss seeing your faces that we've gotten to know over decades of playing in the orchestra. And it makes me emotional, because it's why we became musicians, was to perform and share music with people. And right now, well, thanks to this platform, we can do something. But, you know, I can't play with my string quartet mates or my friends in 45th Parallel or the wonderful people in the viola section that are all my friends. And yeah, I miss it a lot. All of those things. Let's see, what else do we have here? I see Rachel Hadiashar is here. Hi, Rachel. And my wife Stephanie is watching. She's in the living room, so she gets to hear it kind of twice, about 30 seconds apart. I don't see any other questions so far. Let's see, Carrie Kuechel, who used to work for the Oregon Symphony, hi Carrie, asks, is that music room in your new house? And yes, we moved into this house in Milwaukee. It'll be 3 years ago this coming October. And yeah, so I got this lovely room where the sun is streaming in right now. Is where I do all my practicing and work of other kinds that I have. In fact, I'm going to put my instrument down and I'll kind of give you a little bit of a tour. So, pardon the shaky camera work here. But anyway, so here's looking out the window and my desk here, which has got a scanner on it and all sorts of fun stuff. And I've got my art wall, that which I love, which has got the photo of the viola scroll, which I took, and then a picture of a cafe viola underneath that, that my stand partner, Joel Belgique, took when he was in the Czech Republic, I believe, on vacation. And then next to that is a picture of the Space Needle at three different times. And that was taken by my dear friend, Nolan Heisinger, who used to live here in Portland, but now he lives in Nashville. And a wonderful encaustic piece. Oh, and the name of the person, she plays trumpet with the Portland Baroque Orchestra, so she's multi-talented, but I'm spacing on names, which I do all the time. And also right above that is that crow picture was also done by Lori Hustis, who was the principal cello for a long time of PBO. And then, of course, a calendar with cats on it. And, okay, so here's the other thing. You see these webcam concerts and stuff, and everybody's place looks immaculate. But I'm going to show you what the rest of the room looks like to make it kind of look like this. And so we've got various things all over, bags of stuff that needs to be shredded, stuff for physical therapy, just everything is all over the place. So anyway, nobody's life is perfect, so don't feel like you have to live up to how we make it look on the webcam. let's see. Totally, Misty goes, it's like MTV Cribs. Yeah, this is where the magic happens, right here. And I don't, you can't really tell, but I'm doing what all the young, all the kid, the cool kids are doing these days, and I'm playing off an iPad, which is great in a lot of ways because I can have all my music together in one place. I use it a lot for the new music that I play. But you have to turn pages with a foot pedal, and I'm still, even after a couple of years of doing this, I'm getting a little bit, trying to get used to it. Sometimes I hit the wrong one, and the hilarity ensues. So yeah, that's what my studio is like. I'm wondering if there's any other questions. There are cats, but they hate it when I play, so I could open the door, and while I'm talking, they might wander in, but then as soon as I play, they're going to be out of here like a shot. I don't know how I lucked out with getting two cats that can't stand music, but somehow, that's the way it goes. So I want to tell you a little bit more about the viola, because you don't get to see these things up close, and nobody really gets to tell you what all these parts are, but let's see this. And I'll tell you about my viola too, because I'm not lucky enough to have an 18th century viola. I'd love to have one, but I have a wonderful one that was made about 20 years ago by a woman who now lives in Tucson, Arizona, and her name is Gabrielle Kundert. And it's a beautiful instrument, and I really found my voice when I found this. And she's continuing to make really wonderful instruments. This was actually owned by a member of the National Symphony, and it was a copy of his fine Italian viola. And my last teacher and now friend, Roberto Diaz, who is now the president of the Curtis Institute of Music, had a couple copies made of his fine old violas, and he saw this one when he was visiting her shop, and he called me and said, I hear you're looking for a viola. I think this is the one you're looking for. And the rest was history. And then the bow that I have is my newest acquisition. This is made by Daryl Hanks, who's a local maker in Portland. And you can see on the frog there, he did this amazing inlay work of a dragonfly. And that is in honor of my wife, Stephanie, because that's kind of her spirit animal. And she has a tattoo of one of those. And it was just really special to have a really dear friend make this for me. And it's such a beautiful bow. And I'm still learning how to make it. I'm learning how to play with it because it's better than anything I've ever had before. And it's really wonderful. So I don't know how many of you know, but I also have a blog, and it's, the URL is www.nobleviola.com. And I just talk about my life in the orchestra, observations I have about stuff that happens in the music world near and far. And sometimes I go weeks at a time without writing anything. And sometimes I write most every day. But it's a really, really fun thing. I'm stepping on my foot pedal, and my music on my iPad is going nuts right now, so I'm just trying to get it back where it belongs. But if you have a chance and you haven't been to my blog, please do check it out, nobleviola.com. The other thing too is there's a link on the page here for the happy hour to donate, if you would like to the Oregon Symphony, because right now it's really a crucial time for all the major and minor arts organizations in Portland. There's no money coming in because we're not playing concerts, and people can't buy tickets if there's not a concert to go to. And we have a wonderful board and an amazing staff, and they're working super hard to make sure that we weather this and come out and are ready to play for you whenever it's safe to do so. And we're all raring to go. We're ready to do it. But if you have a chance to click on the link here on the page. I'm not sure where it is because I've got 10 things that I'm looking at right now, but I know they said they'd put one up. But or go to the Oregon Symphony website, orsymphony.org, and there's a box there that says donate, and it's super easy, and anything that you can afford to give would be so appreciated, I know, by myself, all my colleagues, our amazing staff, and our amazing board. It's pretty amazing. Our organization, I say amazing a lot, but it is an amazing organization, and I'm so proud to be part of it. And it just fills me with so much joy to know that I'm part of this, and it makes me so sad to know that we can't do what we're supposed to do right now. Let's see, I'm gonna look through here and see what else is happening on here. Nancy Ives, thank you for coming. And she posted a link to the blog. And yeah, okay, yes, Artslandia has a pinned comment that shows you where to donate if you can. And Krista Wessel is here, and she liked the shout out to Daryl. And yeah, so let me tell you a little bit. So I don't know, there's lots of parts to string instruments, and you don't get to see them really up close. And so you've got these four strings here, and this piece of wood here is called a bridge because literally the strings go over it like a road on a bridge. And that transmits all the sound, the vibrations that the strings make into the body of the instrument. And you've got these beautiful F holes, so-called, because they look like the letter F. Really beautiful things. And that allows the air and vibrations to move and for sound to come out. So the majority of the sound comes out of the top here. And then you've got this beautiful scroll on the end, so-called, because it's like a scroll of parchment, the way it curves. And it's just a beautiful work of art. I love looking at scrolls. There are some that are carved like gargoyles and animals' heads and things like that. There's an amazing variety that makers do. And then at this end, you've got the tail piece, which kind of holds all the strings to the body of the instrument, attaches them. And then there's a chin rest, and I happen to use a shoulder pad here. And it's made out of spruce and maple, and the fingerboard's made out of ebony, and the pegs are made, and tailpiece are made out of boxwood. So there's just an amazing amount of stuff going on with these instruments. It's pretty incredible. So the next piece I want to go to is I want to play a little bit of Bach's second cello suite, which is very different from the first. The first is G major, the second is D minor. And Mozart in particular thought of keys very emotionally, and he reserved D minor for his most tragic and sad pieces. D and G minor, actually. But I think of his D minor string quartet. That's one of the great, great quartets that he wrote. But in this case for Bach, it's a very much more of an introspective piece. It's more than tinged with sadness. And so I think it sounds especially nice on the viola because of that. And I'm just going to play a couple of movements, the prelude and the Allemande, the Courant, and the Gigue, to give you kind of an idea of this. And you can really see the development that he's gone through since he wrote the first suite. The first suite is really simplicity itself, even though it's incredibly sophisticated and remarkable. This just takes it another level, and he starts to use even more melodic ideas than he does in the first suite. So I hope you enjoy this. I'm going to do four movements of Bach's second cello suite. Thank you. It's like another world compared to the first. I'm kind of amazed by that. Looking through here to see if there might be some more questions. I see Carrie Lewis is here. Hi, Carrie. Raul Gomez is here. I was on his live stream yesterday, an excellent one. Go check out the MYS page, and he does that every day, every single day, just like Artslandia does. What an amazing community we have here in Portland. It's pretty incredible. I just wanted to close out by talking about a couple of things, which I just sort of did almost just right now. I'm such a natural at this. Oh my God, not really. Come back here tomorrow and the next day and the next day. Artslandia is doing 5 o'clock happy hours with many wonderful artists of all kinds from all around the Portland area. And it's really a wonderful thing. I'm so glad that they're doing it. So please, please come back. I wanted to just thank you for being here. I appreciate it so much. I've never done anything like this before. It was incredibly intimidating. My wife knows I've been worried about this and anxious for days. But it's really been a wonderful experience, and I hope that you have enjoyed it half as much as I've enjoyed playing for you and sharing with you. I'm trying to think if there's anything else. Oh, you know what? I forgot about my viola jokes. So I'm going to tell you a few viola jokes. I talked about this during the pre-run. Violas have been getting a bad rap for literally centuries. And it was maybe well-deserved early on, because if you couldn't play the violin or whatever other instrument very well, they were like, give them a viola. They don't have anything to do and nobody hear them anyway. So that's kind of... It's sad, but true. And so over the years, this culture of joking about the viola and its haplessness and its uncoordinated and crazy, somewhat crazy and not terribly skilled operators. But it's come a long way since then, and some of the finest musicians I know happen to play the viola. So they're, viola power, we rule. And so if you're playing the violin and you're not feeling like, maybe there could be something more, you know what that more is? It's the viola. Get over here. Come over to the light side. Join us in viola land. I promise you will not regret it one bit. So anyway, that's my plug for playing the viola, and I encourage every violinist to at least learn how to read the alto clef and learn how to make a sound on a viola, because it will, at the very least, help your sound on the violin, and at the most, there's more gigs for violas, so come on. There's plenty of violins, not so many violas. So anyway, so here's a few of my favorite viola jokes that I'll round out with, and then I'll play one very short, quick little piece by Max Reger, which hopefully will not come off as a viola joke. But anyway, so here's the first one. What is the definition of perfect pitch? It's when you throw a viola into the trash can without hitting the edge. Yep. I feel a little bit like David Letterman. I should do a top 10 list. What's the difference between a viola and a coffin? Anyone? The coffin has the dead person on the inside. Oh boy. Here's one that's a little bit of a tiny bit of a story joke. So, once upon a time, there was a hospital where they did brain transplants. A client went there and was inquiring about the prices. The doctor said, "Well, the brain of this PhD recipient costs $10,000. And then we have this one that was the brain of a NASA scientist, and that's $15,000. And oh, this is special. We've got a violist's brain, and it costs $50,000." And the client goes, "Why is it so expensive?" And the doctor goes, "It's never been used." I like that one. How can you tell if a violist is playing out of tune? The bow is moving. Ha ha. And this is really my favorite because I feel this one a lot. How are lightning and a violist's fingers alike? They both never strike in the same place twice. Ha ha. I feel that one. Oh my. So, I hope you enjoyed those. I love those viola jokes. There were some that were in really poor taste that I didn't bother to even write down. But catch me somewhere and I might tell you them. But trying to keep it light and happy. So, my last piece is a little slip of a movement. It's barely a minute long. And it's the last movement of another suite by another German composer, Max Reger, who lived from, oh, around 1860 to 1918 or 20, something like that. So he lived into the 20th century, and he has almost the same life. He shares dates almost within a year or two with Max Bruch, who's a composer that you know about because he wrote a violin concerto that everybody plays and everybody loves and everybody knows. Had he not written that, probably nobody would know about Bruch, at least in the general public. There's a few pieces for chamber ensemble, particularly for viola and clarinet and piano, that are wonderful and that we love. But Reger didn't write a breakout piece like that. But he was very much in the vein of Bach. He was the head of a church music program in Leipzig, which was where Bach was at, with St. Thomas Kirche, and not at the same church, but the same city. And he was an organist, and he wrote a ton of music for organ. He wrote a lot of songs, which Bach did not. He wrote cantatas and things like that, but not art songs like Reger did, because that came basically in the late classical and early romantic period. And anyway, he wrote three suites of three pieces each for violin, cello, and viola, which I'm glad he didn't leave us out. We don't have to steal the cello suites this time like we do with the Bach. But they're very much, obviously, inspired by Bach, but then they add the romantic elements of harmony and expression that he lived within. So I think it's an amazing, amazing combination. I'm going to grab my instrument, and I'm just going to give you a tiny bit of a little demo just to have your ears catch the similarity. So in the Bach, where are you? Okay, so in the Bach, there was the courant, which was probably the quickest movement. It was... Okay, remember that one? So this movement of the Reger, which is the last movement of his first suite, is kind of like that. It's a similar sort of animal. It's all in one note value, all 16th notes, and it just kind of goes. And anyway, it's been such a treat for me to perform for you today and talk to you. Please join us. Let me make sure I'm getting all the info that I need to get out. So tomorrow night, I'll also remind you of this after I'm done playing, but Chef Vitaly Paley, who owns several amazing restaurants in town, including Paley's Place, Imperial, and Headwaters, is going to take you step by step through a brand new risotto recipe. I'm going to be tuned into this because I want to do this. I've been to at least two of his restaurants, and they're really, really wonderful. And he's a really great supporter of the arts in Portland and a great citizen of Portland. So that should be really wonderful. So that's tomorrow at 5 p.m., Vitaly Paley. So here's the last movement of Reger's first suite. And again, thank you so much. I've really appreciated being here with you, and I hope you've enjoyed it as well. And please, if you have a chance, please go to the link to donate whatever you're able to the Oregon Symphony. I know all of my colleagues and our board and staff would really appreciate it as well. Thank you so much. Next happy hour tomorrow at 5, Vitaly Paley. It's been so great to be here. Thank you so much.